the time will come up when the winds will stop and the breeze will cease to be breathing. Like the stillness in the wind for the hurricane begins, the hour that the ship comes in. And the seas will split and the ship will hit, and the sands on the shoreline will be shaken. Then the tide will sound and the wind will pound, and the morning will be breaking. Oh, the fishes will laugh as they swim out of the path, and the seagulls, they'll be smiling. And the rocks on the sand all will proudly stand the hour that the ship comes in. And the words that are used for to get the ship confused will not be understood when they're spoken. For the chains of the sea will have busted in the night and be buried at the bottom of the ocean. Well, a song will lift as the mainsail shifts and the boats drift on to the shoreline. And the sun will respect every face on the deck the hour that the ship comes in. Then the sands will roll out a carpet of gold for your weary toes to be touching. And the ship's wise men will remind you once again that the whole wide world is watching. Oh, the foes will rise with the sleep out in their eyes, and they'll jerk from their beds and think they're dreaming. But they'll pinch themselves and squeal, and they'll know that it's for real the hour that the ship comes in. Then they'll raise their hands, say we'll meet all your demands, but we'll shout from the bow your days are numbered. And like Pharaoh's tribe they'll be drowned in the tide, like Goliath they'll be
This is a new day. This is a new day full of sound and light and expectation. This day has been waiting for you. This day has been waiting especially for you to embrace you, to guide you. This day has been waiting with open arms, just for you. This is the day we have been given. Let's not waste it. Come now and let us worship together. And please rise in body or spirit for our first hymn, Love Will Guide Us, in the Gray Hymnal, 131.
Love will guide us.
Can
Hallelujah. I heard that. It's good to be with you all. Welcome, especially if you're new, but everyone, welcome. I've been away for a few weeks. It's really good to be back with you all. I have a few stories to share. And I'm excited to talk about universalism. That was actually something that the worship associates asked that we engage this month. So we'll do that. And I'm excited about talking about it. Immediately following service, UUYO Lawn and Gardens, I love this blurb, about 3,000 square feet of lawn we own lies like an empty canvas before us. What could it be doing for our human and non-human neighbors, and how may that be achieved? Pretty good, right? To begin, let's think creatively together. So look for the guy in the red Ohio State shirt. Where is that guy? It's like Waldo. You join him afterward at 12:15 p.m. And then 7 p.m. tonight, meditation with Linda Scharf. For those who are joining us online, it's on the same Zoom channel that you clicked on. 7 p.m. Eastern today, Linda Scharf meditation. And now an announcement from Lisbeth White, our board president.
Thank you. Fresh off Route 80. So I just want to bring everyone's awareness to our financial state. we've been really committed for a few years now to be transparent with the congregation about what's going on with finances. And, in general, we've done really well over the years and have supported this place that we love. And we're at a point right now where every month our income is dropping, sometimes by 1,000, sometimes by 2,000, sometimes by more. But when our income drops, our expenses pretty much remain the same. There's nothing really to pare from our budget. So the reasons for that are several. Sometimes people die who've been giving. Sometimes people move away who've been giving. Sometimes people's financial situation changes. I just want to bring it to your awareness that we need your support. You need your support. We all need it. I can think of, there are four things you could do today that would help. After the service, Louisa and I will sit at a table during coffee hour with information about, if you're a pledger, if you already give in an ongoing way to the church, you could check on the status of your pledge. Sometimes people just stop giving in the summer. It's like old grade school habit or something. It may just be that you may not be aware. Maybe you've never pledged. Maybe you don't know what I'm talking about with the word pledge. So please come talk to us about that. We are the people that make this place work. And so it needs to come from us. It doesn't come from anybody else. So come talk to us. Yeah, if you're new, definitely come talk to us about how to set up something. We're not asking people to give more than they're capable of, but we are asking that you do a thoughtful pledge of financial commitment to the church. It's a really important part of membership. Two more things. One is we do pay dues on behalf of every member to the regional and national UUA groups. It totals about $87 a piece. Many people said, yes, I will do that. I'll pay that separately so it doesn't have to come out of my pledge, because otherwise you pledge and then it just, we don't get that money. So if you did make that commitment or you are able to, please do follow through or at least have a plan for following through. I know I had to break mine up. I'm going to pay the last bit of mine today. And then the last thing is we have a minister's discretionary fund, which is used at our minister's discretion to support people in the congregation who are going through difficult times. And my understanding is that fund is now, below zero. So there's a lot of need out there. So it's just incumbent upon those of us who are able to give what we can. So thank you very much.
Good morning. I'm Michael Condor, and I will be presenting our chalice laying this morning. Universalism in Christian theology is the belief that the salvation of all souls, that we all share the ultimate destiny of eternal life in heaven. This belief is in line with my belief in a fair and loving God. After all, how could a loving God doom some of their children to eternal punishment and only save a few? How is that fair? But then where is the punishment for the sinners, the wretched and the wicked, the killers, the rapists, and the politicians? As humans, we want to believe in a cosmic justice, and God is that judge. I used to ask every religious leader what hell was like. I would get a variety of answers, an eternal fire of punishment, a dark, cold void of loneliness, a permanent disconnection from God. No one knows for sure. But when I thought about what the worst possible punishment would be, it came to me. Being here again. What if Earth is hell? After all, as the TV show The Good Place tells us, nobody knows how to terrorize and torment humans better than other humans. So if you'll join me in this thought experiment this morning, I would like to submit to you two universalist theories that I have. I had three, but for time and for nerdiness levels, I have cut the third. The first is rooted in a more traditional idea of theology, and the second, I'll admit, is a bit nerdier. In both theories, we must assume that hell does not exist, as God does not want to permanently punish any of their children, but that God does use Earth as a testing ground for souls to live with free will and with the ultimate goal of joining them in heaven. Now, if you believe in reincarnation, this first theory may be for you. My first theory is that we live through our lives through a guided celestial plan of tests and challenges by God in an attempt to help us achieve our best selves. However, if we do not learn all the lessons we need to learn or have not achieved the mission God has set for us, we are reincarnated with the lessons learned imprinted on our souls to continue. The worst parts of ourselves dying with our previous mortal body, or meat mech, as I like to refer to it. When we have completed our mission and learned the lessons our souls needed to learn, when we have achieved our ultimate optimal self, we are finally invited into heaven to finally rest. The second theory I would like to present to you this morning involves multiverse theory. I warned you, nerdy. To put it in simple terms for discussion, multiverse theory suggests that everything that can happen is happening right now somewhere across the many universes that run parallel to our own. Everything everywhere all at once, Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness, and the most recent Spider-Man movies give good examples of this concept. So if we assume the multiverse is real, perhaps we're all living in simultaneous lives across the multiverse. And at the end of those lives, across these universes, God keeps the best version of us and burns away all the others, all the sin, and rewarding the best of us. Both of these theories have a core concept to them that I believe holds true no matter what your personal belief. The only person you're competing with is yourself. These tests that come with living through literal hell can only be conquered through faith that eventually, at the end of all these trials, we will eventually be able to meet again in heaven. So we light this chalice today in the spirit of universalism.
Did everyone grab an order of service? If you didn't, you can look on your neighbors. If you open it up, we have something very special for you. It's called our covenant. It's in the first third. And we'll read it together. Love is the spirit of this church and service its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another.
Our church is supported by pledge income from members and friends like you. If you wish to make an offering to us, please designate so on your check or envelope that it is for UUYO. Our giveaway the plate recipient for July is the Youngstown Lifeguard Academy. With summer at its peak, keeping individuals safe while swimming can be a concern. According to the Centers for Disease Control, each year about 4,000 people die from drowning in the United States. When lifeguards are present at pools or beaches, that risk significantly reduces. Lifeguarding services as important career choice, both to master swimming skills and to develop personally in leadership and community service, and the Youngstown Lifeguard Academy helps vulnerable youth and young adults fulfill that goal. We will now receive the offering that supports the life of Youngstown, the Mahoning Valley, and our wider world.
So this morning for offertory, we thought we'd share a little song with you and a little story that goes with it. This is the last time I heard this recorded was by Pete Seeger, the great American poet and activist. And you may have heard this song. If any of you ever went to church camp, you probably heard this song. If you've ever been to campfires or stuff like that, sometimes you've heard this song. And it goes like this. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and the door will be opened. Ask, and it shall be given, and the love comes a-trickling down. So seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and the door shall be opened. Ask, and it shall be given, and the love will come a-trickling down. All right? So if I go, seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and the door shall be opened, ask, and it shall be given, and the love will come a-trickling down. Well, I set out upon my way on only what I'd heard folks say. You find out along the way that the love comes a-trickling down. And he said, seek,
and he shall find.
Knock,
and the door is open.
Ask, and it shall be given, and the love will come trickling down. Now, in a far-off land, there was a king. And the king decided that he wanted to find the wisdom of the known world and have it all compiled in a book. So the king called his wise men to come in and told them what he wanted. He said, I want you to compile all the wisdom of the known world into a book and bring it to me. So the wise men went off on their way, and it took them over a year, but they came back with this book gilded in gold, and it had all the information of the known world, and they handed it to the king, and the king looked at the book and said, well, this is great, but could you go back out and combine all the wisdom of the known world into one sentence? So, okay. So they went out. This time it took them 5 years. And they came back a little older. And they came back to the king and they said, we have done your bidding, your majesty. And they handed him a piece of paper with the sentence on it. The king says, okay, I wonder, just one more thing. Could you guys go back out and combine the wisdom of the world into one word? Shook their head. It's your bidding, your majesty. And they walked off on their journey. They came back 10 years later, a little grayer, a little older, a little slower. And they walked to the king, and the king had, by this time, almost forgotten what he had told them. You know, and they said, well, you asked us to combine the wisdom of the world into one word, your majesty. And they said, yes, because that's right. Yes. So what did you discover? What is the one word? And they looked at him and they said, maybe. Seek, and knock, and the door shall be opened. Ask, and it shall be given, and the love comes trickling down.
Life is a long, long journey, and we don't know where it ends. So make the journey count, my friend, and the love will come a-trickling down. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and the door will be opened. Ask, and it shall be given, and the love will come a-trickling down. Nice job.
Please join me for a time of silence. Get into a posture that's comfortable for you. Surprised I don't see anyone lying down.
Today's reading is John Murray and the Winds of Change from the Tapestry of Faith. You never know what the wind will blow in or which way the wind blows. The wind can change directions and maybe change your life. It happened to John Murray. As a young man, John Murray had excellent fortune blow his way. He had a fine education, a steady job, a loving wife, and a young son. Life was good. Then suddenly, everything changed. John Murray's wife and their son became sick and died. John lost his job, lost all his money, and was put in jail because he could not pay his bills. John was a very religious man, a universalist, who had even preached about a loving God. Now, he was not so sure what he believed. He felt his life was over. Friends urged him to go someplace where he could start again. He sailed for America on a ship named the Hand in Hand. The wind blew the ship towards their destination, New York. But then fog rolled in and the ship ran aground in New Jersey instead. John and a few others volunteered to leave the ship, go on land, and get directions and supplies. As he was walking ashore, John saw a farmhouse with a small chapel or church beside it. It belonged to Thomas Potter. Thomas Potter greeted John, gave him food for everyone on the ship, and invited John to come back and have dinner with him that night. When John came back, Thomas Potter showed him the chapel. Thomas Potter said that he believed in a loving God who wanted to accept all people into heaven. John said that he believed the same thing. Thomas Potter told John that he had built the chapel and was waiting for God to send him a minister. You, John, are that minister. I have waited for you a long time. John did not want to hear this. He was not a preacher anymore, and he was determined never to preach again. Yet Thomas Potter seemed confident that John was the universalist preacher he had waited for, and he asked John to preach on Sunday. I can't preach on Sunday, said John, because as soon as the wind changes, my boat will set sail and I must be on it. If the boat has not sailed by Sunday, will you preach? Asked Thomas Potter. If I'm still here on Sunday, I will preach, said John Murray. Now what do you think happened? Did the wind blow? Did the Hand in Hand sail away, taking John Murray with it? No wind blew. no ship sailed. John Murray preached on Sunday morning, September 30th, 1770, in the chapel Thomas Potter built for him many years before. The universalist message of the power of love was good news to many who heard. It was good news for John. The winds of change blew yet again for John Murray. He now wanted to preach more than anything, as he did for many years, and hoped to and helped found Universalism in America. He is one of the ancestors our faith home. He is one of the ancestors of our faith home, and we as Unitarian Universalists owe a special thanks to Thomas Potter. It was his hospitality that brought John Murray back to the pulpit. We also owe a special thanks to the wind that blew him in and would not blow him out.
May God bless and keep you always. May your wishes all come true. May you always do for others and let others do for you. May you build a ladder to the stars and climb on every rung, and may you stay forever young, forever young, forever young. May you stay. May you grow up to be righteous. May you grow up to be true. May you always know the truth and see the light surrounding you. May you always be courageous. Stand upright and be strong. And may you stay forever young, forever young, forever young. May you stay forever young. May your hands always be busy. May your feet always be swift. May you have a strong foundation when the winds of changes shift. May your heart always be joyful. May your song always be sung, and may you stay forever young.
We never know where the winds of change will take us, or sometimes a lack of wind. It's amazing, all the people, places, and things we are connected to seemingly, allegedly, through chance, a strong wind, or a lack of wind. On the spur of the moment, I had the great fortune to visit Maine while I was away, a state I had never been to before, but a state that had oddly visited me again and again through the winds of change. And I'll explain how that's possible. The story goes that two people from the lumber industry went out west to the newly formed state of Oregon. One man from Boston, Massachusetts, one man from Portland, Maine. The story goes, the legend, they flipped a coin to decide what they would name this new port city on the Pacific Ocean. Tail, Boston. Heads, Portland. What do you think it was? We stayed in Bath, Maine, the capital of wooden shipbuilding in the 19th and early 20th century. I learned there were no schools that taught wooden shipbuilding. So the only way to learn was to become an apprentice. And I found this fascinating. Formerly enslaved Africans made their way up north to Maine, and one or two became apprentices and learned how to build a joiner and work in the blacksmith shop and do very specialized jobs. And then they invited formerly enslaved Africans to come up north to Maine, where they had an apprenticeship program teaching people. So at one time, in the late 19th and early 20th century, there was a sizable black community in the small little port city of Bath, Maine, about 40 miles north of Portland. But then the winds of change came through right before the Great Depression, and the world shifted to steel. Are we familiar with that? It shifted to steel and away from wood. So that population in Bath, Maine migrated to places like Pittsburgh, Youngstown, Detroit, Chicago. All those jobs, all that learned apprenticeship, no longer necessary anymore. Another current in the winds of change. I could feel all this on a warm June day, watching the fog roll in with the wind, bringing a chill and some moisture in the air, making it harder to see these great bridges and monuments so lovingly crafted by hand. Another aspect of sea life I became interested in were lighthouses. I relearned, or perhaps never knew, that before automation, lighthouse keepers would live in relative isolation, keeping watch at night, and also managing the lighthouse during the day to keep it functional. Lighthouse keepers were known to be very eccentric people, and many people thought it was because they lived in relative isolation. But years later, it was discovered that inside the light of the lighthouse were trace amounts of mercury. And since the lights needed to be managed by hand, a lighthouse keeper would come in contact with mercury dozens of times in the course of months, coming right straight into their pores. So this later explained why some lighthouse keepers were known to be quite kooky. But I saw an interview with an old lighthouse keeper who lived in one before automation. He felt a calling, he said, and he described it, I love this, he described it as intensely boring. Intensely boring. With small bouts of life and death situations. And then he said, with only a hint of a smile, it suited him. He said, you have to have a mind large enough to endure the subtlety of what was always happening right in front of your face, each gust of wind, each stillness where no wind was to be found. You had to have a mind large enough for that. I think Thomas Potter had the spirit of a lighthouse keeper. John Murray, in one version of the story I was told, was shipwrecked. That's how it was told to me originally. And I think that's a really great term, shipwrecked, because he was shipwrecked emotionally long before he wrecked on the shores of New Jersey. The winds of change dealt Murray a very tough hand, one I can hardly imagine dealing with. He lost his wife and his children. He lost his business and spent time in debtor's prison. On the surface, it would seem unlikely that a person who had dealt with all of this would profess a God that loves you. And in my imagination, I wonder if it was a gospel he too nightly questioned, doubted. I certainly have. And I think I would even more so if I was in his position. In my imagination, I wonder if perhaps Murray was trying to live a quiet, private life while he grieved and salvaged what was left of his life. I imagine, and I've never heard it told this way, but this is what I imagine. I imagine Potter not being the hero. I imagine Potter being the burr in his side, saying in so many words, "The home you knew, you will never return to. The destination you sought out, you will never reach. Listen to the wind, man. There is no wind for you. There is no home to salvage where you've come from. Here, on this foreign soil, here, in this place you wish to spend a night or two at most, is your new home, if you're willing to see it." To this day, I don't know how many of us would want to be shipwrecked on the coast of New Jersey. It wouldn't be what I would hope for or what I would expect. So I'm not surprised that Murray felt this way, especially in the 19th century. He tried mightily to get out of that situation. And I don't think it was easy for him. How could it be? To be stuck on soil he didn't want to be on, longing for a home he found it impossible to get to. Perhaps he hummed to himself the old hymn, "By the waters of Babylon," and I imagine him weeping for a home that demanded wind, but no wind was to be found. Love is often described as a fullness, but in this case, I think love showed up as an absence, which is most peculiar, an absence of a thing longed for, an absence of wind, an absence of the ingredients necessary for a plan. Potter, annoyingly to me now, had a plan all along. He tells Murray, "I built you a church." And there is no public record of this, but I imagine Murray thinking and perhaps saying, "F your church." I do. "Screw your church. I want to go home, or at least New York. I want to see the place that is familiar, the place I want, a place I could have a life. I'm not American. I'm English. I don't need a church. Thank you, Mr. Potter. I need a home." And Potter slyly insists, and I think this is very bold and sly and a bit annoying to me, that this wreckage, this lack of wind, is divine providence. He tells Murray, "I've been waiting for you to come." It's so good to finally see you. It's poignant to me that all that is here this morning, in this church, because of a shipwreck. We're here because someone's plans were thwarted. We're here because another person saw an opportunity, even though it was not the opportunity that was wanted. And that, I see, is something maybe all of us might have in common, at least sometimes. It seems to be part of our condition that sometimes love shows up not as our preference, but an affront to our preferences. The thing that gets in our way, that keeps us from sailing home or sailing on to where we want to go, is the thing. Sometimes. Sometimes. Not always. I've been struck by how many times the holy in the First Testament comes about through great yearning and grappling. It doesn't come easy. Even if it looks easy, in a certain sense, from the outside. From the outside, Murray's life looks very clear and direct. You're shipwrecked in Jersey. There's no way out. You have experience with a faith that has not been expressed on this soil here yet. And lo and behold, someone has built a church where they want you to preach and lead. That sounds very convenient on one level, except the layers of levels underneath that are huge that say, I'm not even sure I want to stay in America. I'm not sure I want to preach in a church. I don't want what is present. I want what is impossible right now, the conditions to go somewhere else. On one level, the beginning of universalism begins with a tragedy, a happy, strange tragedy for us. And in time, Murray and others saw that what they were doing mattered, even if it was not what they first wanted or intended. How true is that for most of us, I think? I'm imagining. I have a sense it's true. For some of us, sometimes. I feel that the ocean and the desert, they give me a similar feeling. They both give me a feeling of endless expansion, tumultuousness, unpredictability. They both make me yearn for some kind of refreshment, a drink of water, or a nice wind. A nice breeze. It's the expansiveness itself that creates the yearning. I think yearning for home and yearning for love are pretty close. And I can't get enough of stories of people, both real and fictional, who yearn and grapple their way to some place. Jacob, wrestling with the angel, giving his brother a hot cup of soup in exchange for the right to be firstborn, grappling, clawing his way into some idea of what he thinks he wants, and it both works and doesn't work. It leaves him limping, injured, hurt. He carries the memories and scars of all the grappling, the fight to get something dimly comprehended, but irresistible. We are drawn to what we are drawn to, and we may not even know why. Even the reasons we can list only scratch the surface. The yearning is so deep. The yearning for love, whatever that is, even if we're not sure. The yearning for home, even though that may feel both totally real and totally elusive. And the frustration, the key ingredient needed that never seems to arrive, or the pile of ingredients given that feel completely unnecessary and annoying. Too little of what we want, too much of what we don't. I love that James Baldwin explained that he felt his loneliness and pain was the most distinguished and unique thing in the world until he started reading. And in reading, he saw his pain and loneliness reflected back at him in the lives of people through the generations, forced to live as an alien on foreign soil. The people who felt displaced, the people yearning for what they do not have, spitting in the face of what they do have, wishing it to be otherwise. There's a part of our faith tradition that I never understood until this year. I wonder if universalism in the year 2023 invites, perhaps even demands of us, to listen to the losses, to pay special attention to the yearning, to patiently chronicle the hopes and wishes long deferred, to open ourselves to the truth that perhaps sometimes, if not all the time, we as individuals and as a community may feel displaced, marooned, shipwrecked. To listen to our experiences of hanging on by a thread and then having that thread taken away. And then, only then, pray that we might be able to accurately notice what we have, even if it's not what we aimed for. To feel as clearly as possible what the absence may be teaching us, as much as the presence. To be unafraid of the absence. To feel our way through the contours of absence into a new kind of invitation. For Murray, it turned out unbelievably that his great misfortunes, his great losses, led to many people on this soil, especially in Ohio, believe it or not, to find an articulation of a faith they had never heard before, but desperately desired. That desire spurned an evangelical movement of people who would go to the far reaches of this country to find people that yearned for that same message, a love that would never abandon you, even and especially when you thought you were certain you were abandoned. A love that would steadfastly and patiently pull you from the wreckage and literally save you and us from our worst impulses. It may sound kind of quaint now, but I think there's a power still in that. The power comes for me from the experience of people like Murray, who know what it's like to lose. Who know what it's like to lose. Who knows what it's like to feel disappointment. Who knows what it's like to receive an invitation that you never asked for. That depth of human feeling and yearning is what gives, in my mind, our faith its depth, its truth, its life-saving potential. It's familiar with the contours of absence and is unafraid to meet what is tender and hurt. It's a human feeling that gives its power. In our history, we often hold Thomas Potter up with reverence and gratitude, the person who convinced Murray to go with where the wind would not. But I was having a conversation with someone just yesterday, and I think the special thing is the meeting between these two people. That meeting brought something together that is here today in this room and out in the world. It's a promise that the absence, in the absence, through the absence, something new can be born. Please pray with me. Spirit of love, so grateful for this day. We offer a special blessing for the people in Wellsville, Ohio, in Columbiana County, for a beautiful Pride celebration yesterday and this weekend. Thank you for all who courageously made that possible for our community and our world. So grateful to be here among people we know and people that we don't know as well. Please help us to open to both equally this morning. Please help us to stay for a little tea, coffee, water, a little snack, so we can get to know each other and be with each other. And may we enjoy the nice gusts of wind from electronical fans and from a breeze that every so often comes our way. All this we pray. Amen. Please rise in body or spirit for our last hymn. Okay. So it's in the hymnal, 279, By the Waters of Babylon, and is it in our gray or in our teal? It's in the gray, Jeff.
There's a version in each one.
Oh, okay.
The one that
gotcha.
We're doing is in the teal.
Gotcha. Okay. Okay. We'll pass out the teal, and Jeff will lead us through that.
It is number 1042.
All right, 1042. And Ralph, I'll take one too. Thanks. 1042. Thank you.
Yeah, there are probably several different versions of this song.
What number is it? Yes.
1042.
Yeah, 1042.
Everybody have it? By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down.
How can we sing out the song?
come back to the beginning.
From the Babylon, where we sat down, and there we were, when we remember Zion, by the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down, and there we were, when we
we did it. Thank you. As you depart, please remember the one great fact: you are loved and never truly alone.
May your hands always be busy. May your feet always be swift. May you have a strong foundation when the winds of changes shift. May your heart always be joyful, and may your song always be sung, and may you stay forever young.